Welcome, everybody. Thanks for having me here today. It's a bit exciting, as you can imagine, in this TV studio, but I'm looking forward to the coming 50 minutes, and I hope you are doing that as well. I want to share my thoughts on sharing. Yes, I'm Peter Krootjes. I'm a product owner at the technical platform for Teams Insights and Excel. I have also had experience in a manager role at a checkout fleet, but I'm also a hobby developer. And from that enthusiasm, I want to share this story today. I know many colleagues that are joining today also have the same hobby, and probably it increased a lot with the lockdown recently. I hope I can leave you with some of my recommendations. Two things I want to share with you. Sharing code. Yes, please. I think that's certainly a good idea. But if you do so, please take it seriously. So sharing code, why is that a good thing for developers? The sharing economy, you can think of a bedroom sharing with Airbnb or your car. No, there's a lot of industry in that, but it can be difficult. But replication of your code is free, right? So sharing your code is really, really easy. Moreover, we all talk the same language, right? We are all connected, we're online, the whole thing of developers is actually on the internet. So it makes it really easy to share code. And last but certainly not least, we are really used to share code, right? We work in layers, we work with dependencies and libraries, and this makes that we trust on other people's work. If it's shared by somebody, some open source library, we use it, we trust it, even often we don't even understand it anymore. We don't need to understand it anymore, right? Somebody else build it, and that's good enough. And that's a great thing. But I believe it's not only a technical, rational reason that we are sharing code. It's also a feeling, an emotional thing that we do that. It feels good to share your code with others. It feels good if you have solved your puzzle and you build something really great that you can share it with somebody else. It's actually, in my view, it's in the mind of a developer that you are trying to be efficient, that you want to avoid deduplication. You don't want to reinvent the wheel. It's really a push to say, hey, somebody else is just doing the same thing next to me. Why not share it with him? All those reasons, I think it's important to share code. And I see a lot of people in this company are sharing their code. So you decide to share your code. For example, a code snippet, somebody sitting next to you say, hey, I also solved a problem here. Maybe you can use it like this. Or there is a question somewhere on the forum. Of course, we have our nice Confluence questions. Now, you decide to answer it. Nice, thank you. And I see that also happening a lot, we share some of our code with a bigger group, for example, in your team or your department. And you make a little framework that everybody can use. And at some point, you also see people maybe originating from a hackathon that they make a handy service and the whole IT department is starting to use it. But ho, stop it there, please, because this is probably not the only thing that's what's happening, because somebody will start to ask you questions about it. Hey, how does it actually work? Oh, didn't think about that during the hackathon. Somebody really likes it and asks for an extension. Oh, a feature request. Yeah, maybe I can add that too. Why not? But then at some point, security comes along and says, hey, there's a vulnerability in your code. Everybody is now using this. Please take it seriously. And then this thing happens, right? So the Eiffel Tower building is certainly a big endeavor. It was a big endeavor. But that's not the only thing that needs to be done, right? So the guy on the right, you can see, painting the whole thing every year again since the Eiffel Tower was built is actually the biggest effort. The maintenance is the effort that's really tricking you. And that's where my little model comes in here. I will show it on screen. Imagine, it's not too difficult, that you have two axes. So you have the investment on the left side and the maintenance on the support effort on the right side. Yeah, if you have a question on a forum, you decide to answer it. Maybe somebody comes back and says, it's not really clear to me. And you can decide to add that. But if you make a script or a helper service, then people start to depend on it. And they will expect you to give you some support. And if there's a framework for the department or even a company-wide framework, like the famous Axel framework that we're working on in Team Axel, then people really expect a high level of support. And they are right in expecting that. It doesn't work if you do not give the support with it. They depend on you now. And I'm really amazed by this, but this goes up and up, this model. There are even companies that make their complete money, billion worth companies that make their money based on these kind of models, like GitLab or Elastic. In the basis, it's open source, it's shared code, but they make money because they support it. And they give you the all the means to actually operate it and depend on it. Let me pick out two that I think are interesting. They are important for the bol.com landscape, maybe also outside. I hope you recognize them. And I think a lot of people discuss these kind of things at bol.com. So on the left side, if you have a handy service, then often you see it depends on a single person. It comes from, I don't know, a hackathon product, project, an evening job of somebody. Really cool. People start to use it. When usage increases, it can feel like a lot of pressure to these people that's building this. Of course, you can think of Discover, Docs.io, Proxer. There are many tools in the company that are originating like this. If you decide to share it with more people, there's a fantastic talk later today from the real-time sales, then who is really the ownership? Is it these two guys that built this fantastic tool, or is there actually a team behind? And did you think about management involvement, right? A product owner, a team manager, or is it just your own hobby, and will it always stay in the evenings? If people start using it, they will ask the question to you, can we count on it? Then on the right side, we have this company-wide framework, which seems like an easy solution. In my view, it's not. It's really difficult to prove that resources should be added for something shared, to share code amongst a bigger group. I see that a lot of struggles within the company of these kind of frameworks that are not moving from a hobby or from a one-person thing towards a fully supported one. If you have these people, then the structure is really helping and the resourcing is really helping to give you that support. But of course, if it's separated, it's a separated team, then a new thing emerges, and that's you need to stay connected with the users. You're not only building it for yourself now, but yeah, how do you actually make the things that people like? Did I tell everything? I hope so. So, concluding my learnings, and this probably won't be new for you, but I hope you recognize it. If you start something as a hobby or a hackathon project, and you are a developer and you really love to do that, then at the right moment, think about support. Think about what is it, if lots of people are using it, what do I need to do? Involve other people like your product owner, your manager. Maybe don't wait too long with structure and maybe even resourcing. Make it a team. Do not let it depend on yourself. If you come across an accident or you leave the company and you want to continue that this is being used, you need really other people along with you. But this is my last slide. Sharing is caring. I really believe the development community is special. You are special. The IT world is special because we are built on sharing. That's really different than a lot of other industries. We are used to work with open source. A lot of stuff that we build is just given by somebody else. So please continue doing that and take it seriously if people really like it. That was my story. Thank you for listening. Back to you, Tim.